Concilier biodiversité et société, est-ce possible?
Reconciling society and biodiversity, is that a possibility? First of all, we're going to look at what would be necessary. Some thought was given to public policies which might be necessary. The first public policy, which comes to mind intuitively, consists in limiting our impact on ecosystems, which means finding out what ecosystems we're not going to exploit and which ecosystems we will exploit more moderately. Once we implement a public policy, the next social question is, what about fairness and equal distribution? Because as long as the quantity of resources on planet is infinite, endless, we can always think that poorest populations will still be able to supply themselves from the ecosystems that are not exploited and natural resources which have not been used and plundered. But once we understand that the resources are not endless and that we're already exploiting the resources that can be exploited, this type of attitude is no longer acceptable and we need to share between poor countries and rich countries. The third type of public policy regards efficacy, efficacy of economic activities, efficacy in the way we use natural resources. For a given human need, how to use as little natural resources as possible. This type of public policy is very popular with the economic players. Why is that? Because it obviously provides an economic advantage to companies and farms. Those who know how to be efficient will obviously have an advantage and they will supersede the other economic players. But economists for some time have shown that this has a perverse effect, the bounce back effect. When efficacy increases, the benefit associated with the use of natural resources increases, and the social pressure will increase as well, which will stimulate the use we make of ecosystems. Increased efficacy is definitely interesting, and it should help us limit our impact on ecosystems, except that if we don't constantly think about mitigating our impact on ecosystems, the effect will be counterproductive and we will end up increasing our use of ecosystems. How to limit our impact on ecosystems? Can that be done? Ecologists clearly say yes, because if we draw a list of human activities that have the greatest impact on ecosystems, agriculture comes first. Cultivated land, 40% of the cultivated land is dedicated to other activities than directly feeding human beings. For instance, we produce biofuels or fodder to feed animals, to produce animal proteins. If we were to use all of the arable land to feed human beings directly, we definitely could feed 40% more people, more than enough to feed the population we expect on Earth for the 21st century. So there are ways to revise the way we use ecosystems and the way we organize agricultural activities in order to mitigate our impact on the ecosystem. But mitigating the impact, will that be sufficient to achieve our objective? Politically, one might be tempted to say no, because acceptability will not be sufficient. It might end up with what is called punitive ecology. Mitigating our impact on ecosystems should go hand in hand with improved well-being and happiness for societies of human beings. Perspectives are interesting. Here we have a graph comparing the situation of countries globally, countries with a very small footprint, ecological footprint, African countries on the left-hand side, and on the right-hand side we have developed countries, Australia, the United States, and a number of European countries with very high footprint. Now, vertically we have the index of human development, one-third of national rich longevity, and education, one-third each. This graph shows that by increasing the footprint, we also increase human development and possibly human satisfaction and happiness. But beyond a certain ecological footprint, there is a plateauing effect, and the increased footprint does not have a social benefit. Well-being does not increase anymore. So by revising the way we use ecosystems, we could decrease our impact on ecosystems. Socially and politically, the question is still unanswered. Philosophers and economists have developed a concept called capability. Nobel Prize winner Amartya Sen elaborated this concept, which was then confirmed by a philosopher called Martin Nussbaum, listing 10 capabilities which are health, quality of social relationships, emotion, empathy for other species. And Martha Nussbaum explains that some material wealth is only a way to provide better answers to human aspirations, which are really the meaning of life and what matters to us, human beings. So by reviewing what we are motivated by and what we love, what we aspire to, we understand that this can be associated with a reduced impact on ecosystems. By reviewing and revising our human aspirations, we can mitigate our impact. But will this be sufficient? Because our societies have a complex organization, 7 billion people on Earth. But the models are quite reassuring, because the models show that if people living in rich countries were to agree to invest productivity increase, not to increase consumption, but to increase leisure time, for instance, markets spontaneously would turn to the poorest countries, the only countries still offering opportunities for increased production, and capitalist markets would spontaneously reduce unfairness and poverty in favor of Southern Hemisphere countries. In conclusion, if we were to revise our aspirations, if we think seriously about what really matters in human life, we can reduce our impact on ecosystems, and the economic functioning and political functioning of societies is quite compatible with this ambition.